I got work to do. Yeah. Hang on. The pole's in the way a little bit.
Go, defense! Stop the boys! Oh, yeah! Nice play!
Shot!
14-0 St. Paul.
Yeah.
Hang on.
Stop on those
blocks.
Yeah!
play. Give me a second.
Yeah! boys, up the door! Jack,
cover, cover, cover. Go, 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 go!
Yeah! Yeah. Go! wide open. So I'm standing there. Oh, wide open.
Give me a second.
Short side option turns into a touchdown.
We have a second sideline warning. Charge to the Notre Dame bench. Play stands. Touchdown.
Must be the official getting tripped up a couple of times for sideline warnings to come up back-to-back situations, but it's been quite a quarter for the sophomore out of Arlington Heights, Tom Zbikowski. First the interception to set up one score and 75 on the fumble return there. DJ Fitzpatrick adds the extra point. A little bit of everything in the first quarter and a 14-7 Notre Dame lead.
What I loved about Zbikowski here is the way, now Reeves comes down the line, and this is lack of experience with the option. He needs to continue down to make Zbikowski commit and then pitch it out. He did not do that. Zbikowski's able to play the quarterback, then come out and play the running back. Good job of ripping the ball loose, and now he's going the other way. But that was outstanding athletic ability by Zbikowski, but also poor job of running option football by Steven Reeves.
But also well-coached position by Zbierkowski. He was in perfect position there. And you know what? That's a new trend all over the country, that stripping. We saw LSU do it against Auburn 3 or 4 times. That's the NFL coming into college football, stripping the football away from the runners.
That is textbook Tyrone Willingham and Kent Bear, their defensive coordinator. We talked to him this week. He said, we emphasize turnovers. We have drills every day in practice. And then Thursday, we have a circuit, and we rip balls out of ball carrier's hands. We jump on top of it. Kent Bear, I know, is going to be very excited when he has a chance to look back at that one. That was a big play. And I'll tell you, when you start to do it every game and every year, it's not luck. This is just the way they coach their defense.
And remember, Dennis Green had Tyrone Willingham as an assistant for 6 years in the pros. Those guys do that, Mike. They do that as an everyday thing, like Kurt said. I think it's a wonderful trend for the coaches to do in college.
Ah! Thank you. left behind them. Come on, come on.
defenders too. And up for Shelton, and I'll tell you, I think Shelton all of a sudden has become Brady Quinn's best friend after that interception. And you talked about a no-no throw him back into right. The defense. Big drive right here in a big series for Brady Quinn to get going again.
Give Bill Dietrich, the offensive coordinator, a lot of credit on that. It was a first down play action after Ryan Grant had made that good run. They faked the same play and came across and hit Shelton for a touchdown. That's a nice call because the defense has a tendency to look to that tailback again. Touchdown.
No question. Bill Dietrich seeing the same thing right. We are on first and second down. The Michigan State safeties are running up to the line of scrimmage to try to overload to take away Ryan Grant and Darius Walker from running the football.
Shelton had the 53-yard catch earlier in the game out of Collierville, Tennessee. So it's back-to-back weeks with touchdowns.
Yo, say ball!
Is there any more? Oh! our leadership and our unity. Actually, I believe the guy is sincere. He does really want to play.
Yeah.
Oh, they did run the kickoff.
All the way below!
I can never get
Yeah.
Jackson.
There you go. every time I visited with him in the hospital, he expressed gratitude and appreciation for my being there. I kept thinking to myself, I'm the one that's being strengthened by this man.
Tom Landry, the former coach of the Dallas Cowboys, was not only a champion many times over, he was one of football's great innovators. Landry died of leukemia yesterday at the age of 75.
When he passed away, so many people came back and said, gosh, Coach Landry had such a dramatic effect and a change in my life. And the thing that Coach Landry did that was so unique is that he planted a seed within you that just continued to grow for a long time. You didn't know it. And it really changed you as a person.
People thought who idolized him that he was perfect. People thought who found him hypocritical that he was a charlatan. He wasn't either one of those things. And I think the best thing people can say about him is that he was a human being. He was a hell of a human being, but he was a human being.
In the mid-60s, a false bomb scare in the press box had briefly halted play during a Cowboy game. Afterwards, Tom Landry was asked by a reporter what he would have done had there actually been a bomb and it had gone off. Landry wryly replied he would have observed a moment of silence and then resumed playing with enthusiasm. For Sports Century, I'm Chris Fowler.
Catch a full season of Sports Century Profiles, 8 p.m. weeknights on ESPN Classic.
I don't believe it! Phelan is at the bottom of that pile!
Behind the net, the center, to Orr! 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 Orr!
Play made! The puck has gone to his feet! This is a big
difference!
Hello, I'm Chris Fowler, and welcome to Sports Century. In one critically important way, college football entered the 21st century with one foot stubbornly planted in the distant past. Of 115 Division I-A head coaches after the 2001 season, only four were African American. The most prominent was Tyrone Willingham of Stanford. Then the earth moved when the most hallowed shrine of the sport looked into its soul, wrestled with its tradition, and made an historic decision.
Notre Dame is special. It cares about honor, and it cares about God, and it cares about family and country.
Notre Dame came along at a time in their football program when the country was in need for heroes, in need for tradition, in need for an institution they can cling to, and Notre Dame happened to be that institution.
With 11 national titles and 7 Heisman winners, the most storied program in college football fell from earth. In December of 1999, Notre Dame was put on 2 years probation for booster violations. Then, in March of 2002, became mired in scandal when 3 players were charged with sexual misconduct.
This kind of boggles the mind that Notre Dame once stood for something and in the 90s just sort of slid into the gutter.
There's a little tarnish on the Golden Dome. And what better way to polish it than to give us the high road of an African-American head coach.
Enter one ramrod straight, clear-eyed head coach with an unassailable reputation.
Tyrone Willingham is the highest in ethics and professionalism. He has purpose. He's a taskmaster. He brought more to Notre Dame than any other coach possibly could.
I do believe there is a greater good, that we're out there to benefit not just yourselves, but to benefit others. So is this significant? Yes, I say it is significant.
Willingham was more ready to coach than Notre Dame was to hire him.
We could play baseball before 1947. We could play basketball before 1950. We could have coached at Notre Dame before year 2002.
College football should have to answer not why an African-American was hired, but why so few African-Americans have been hired.
It's racism. It's a part of the overall American society, and athletics are a microcosm of society. It's clearly racism.
For the 1979 season, Wichita State hired the first African-American head coach in Division I-A. Over the next 23 years, just 16 others were given the top job.
Can I work hard? Can I go to clinics? Can I go to schools? Can I recruit? I can do all this, but when time's to come promote, I become invisible.
There's a belief in college that, well, if I hire a black coach, the people who donate money won't donate as much money.
College football programs are the major revenue source of the athletic department. And athletic directors, are they willing to put that huge moneymaker in the hands of that particular coach?
Willingham will be seen, for the most part, as that same black guy. There will be a lot of people waiting on him to make a poor judgment call, put together a poor game plan, because those are, quote, typically black mistakes.
But before Willingham would face such criticism, he first had to get the job by running a gauntlet of resistance after Notre Dame fired head coach Bob Davie in December of 2001. Leading the way was the Black Coaches Association.
We sent qualified candidate lists to every Division I institution in this country that played football.
We immediately contacted Notre Dame. We certainly thought there were some clear candidates, including Tyrone Willingham, that deserved consideration.
They had publicly expressed an interest in Tyrone Willingham. To get critics off their backs, it made it look as if Notre Dame was seriously interested and was going to consider Tyrone Willingham as a candidate, when that wasn't the case at all early on.
Willingham was Notre Dame's first interview.
I had no control over this procedure. The only thing that I had control over was my presentation in the interview.
I was the person that was the conduit to each of six people that we spoke to originally. And I was looking for somebody to gush back at me about Notre Dame.
Tyrone is not going to come in here and overwhelm you and gush at you in a first meeting.
Tyrone wanted to make sure what is being set up to make them successful before he could say, yes, I want the job. And so it's difficult when someone's trying to recruit you and you're not as excited as they are for them to say, okay, well, let's go for it.
While we felt that there were so many positives about Tyrone, there was concern about how much did he really want to be here. And I think that's what kept the search going at that point.
I did not believe that I had the opportunity to be the head coach at Notre Dame.
I called Ty and I said, what's the possibility of you withdrawing your name? And he said, no, I'd never give him the easy way out like that.
As he suspected, Willingham was passed over for someone who better fit the Notre Dame mold. George O'Leary, an Irish Catholic with 34 years of coaching experience, was hired.
Ty was very quick to say, Kevin, you made the wrong call. You made the wrong decision. I'm your guy.
I relayed to him the confidence that I had in myself and that I could be the head coach that they desired.
I needed to hear that because it really signified just how much that Ty really wanted to be the head football coach at Notre Dame.
White would soon get the chance to reconsider Willingham. 3 days after O'Leary took the job, it was revealed that he had lied on his resume. Notre Dame accepted his resignation and scrambled to come up with a credible option.
Notre Dame used to be the kind of school that when they went looking for a coach, every coach in the country wanted to come there. They didn't have that this time.
I asked Notre Dame not to talk to our coach, so I sort of withdrew permission for them to talk to our coach, unless they were going to offer him the job.
It was important for him to bring in somebody that stopped the snickering. They needed a sure thing, and he provided the closest thing to a sure thing.
On December 30th, Notre Dame made contact with Willingham. He accepted its offer the next day and became the institution's first African-American head coach in any sport.
You can't sit around as black coaches and say that we're not getting coaching opportunities at the best schools. And then when you have a coaching opportunity like that, rejected.
If he didn't take the job at Notre Dame, who else in the near future would get a chance at a job like that?
It would be the highest prestige program that an African-American coach would have an opportunity to coach. It becomes a job that you can't say no to.
Despite Willingham's deep experience, which included 4 bowl games in his 7 years as head coach at Stanford, Notre Dame felt it necessary to sell their choice to the public.
Monk Malloy, Kevin White were so effusive in their praise of Tyrone Willingham the day he was hired. Well, why didn't they go after him to begin with? Because it was clear that he was not their number one candidate, or number two, or number three. Even after the O'Leary debacle, Willingham was not the immediate choice.
He was the total bailout for Notre Dame, considering all that occurred. Notre Dame got the greater bargain here.
It's not a bold move to hire a qualified candidate. What the hell is bold about that? It's the safest thing in the world for Notre Dame. The only person incurring any risk here is Ty Willingham.
The last thing that I would ever want to do was hire an African-American coach for Notre Dame who didn't have institutional fit, because in the end, that'll come back to haunt you.
It helps to know the people who know diamonds. With a stunning selection to choose from, you know that you'll find just the perfect one for her. Zales, the diamond store.
Shave your beard. Not your face. Introducing the new Norelco Cool Skin Shaver. Close as a blade with less irritation.
Is your financial company giving you the security you need?
We're in. Hey, join the evolution. Okay, we're out.
Because it's your future.
This ESPN Classic on Performance is brought to you by IBM.
The legend begins at the NCAA Final in the Superdome. Georgetown leads by a point with 15 seconds left when a freshman named Michael Jordan sticks a jumper.
I'd like to say that I contributed to Michael's career. You know, I gave him confidence enough to know that he could hit a lot of big shots.
Jordan's shot gives the Tar Heels a 63-62 victory, their first championship under Coach Dean Smith. March 29th, 1982.
Hello.
Yo.
Where are you?
I'm in London. Where are you?
We're in Paris. I thought you were in Tokyo.
Thought you were in Boston.
Change of plans. What's up?
Change of plans. We need to reroute the shipment.
New terms?
New terms, new specs, new schedules.
Show me.
There you go.
Change of plans. Okay. Will do. See you in New York.
Change of plans. See you in L.A.
Au revoir.
Sayonara.
So what's up? The usual.
When change is part of the plan, that's on-demand business from IBM.
Born on December 30th, 1953, Tyrone was raised in Jacksonville, North Carolina by his parents, Nathaniel and Lillian Willingham.
I was blessed with a true dichotomy of parents. My father didn't have the opportunity to an education. My mother had a master's degree from Columbia, but their values were alike.
My mother was a school teacher. My father was a landlord in the community. My parents were very supportive of the city, allowing them to run a recreation program out of our basement. And subsequently, we donated land for the construction of a recreation center.
We've always felt that whatever you're doing, you have a responsibility to those that have gone both before you and those that will come after you from your community.
Growing up during the early years of integration, Tyrone learned how to deal with the changing times. Often the voice of reason was his father.
He would always say that the two of us could go out and we could whip a bear with a switch. In life, don't be afraid of the challenges. Be prepared, but have confidence that you can go out and tackle whatever obstacles come your way.
The shock of integration was the playing field wasn't fair, and there were limitations.
We were taught that you had to be twice as good if you wanted to stay even and three times as good if you wanted to get ahead.
There was, you know, the racial issues there, but I think a lot of times they were more subtle.
The quarterback that they had then, he wasn't even half as great as Tyrone was. The other black players on the team, we talked about it amongst each other, but I never heard Tyrone say anything about it because it's like he was saying, my day will come. And in fact, it did come, and he became a senior, became the starting quarterback.
If his strength of character came from his parents, Willingham's patience with racial inequity was partly the result of living near Camp Lejeune, a U.S. Marine base.
It's a little bit different in our town because we grew up in a military town.
You had people from the north, people from, you know, all over the country that were stationed there.
In the military, blacks went to war, whites went to war, and both died. And we realized that.
It never affected us athletically because we had just grown up together and we were friends, and it didn't matter the color of your skin.
I was blessed to have good coaches that kind of led us into that process, and I also had some excellent teammates that we began to come together and kind of bring the community together through our athletic play.
He was so much more mature in his thinking than a lot of the other kids. We had our faculty meetings on Wednesday, so I'd have to leave a practice schedule with Tyrone, and when I walked back in the gym, it was just like I'd been there the whole time.
A lot of times before the coaches would come out on the field, he'd get different people lined up, and then we'd run pass patterns or we'd run sprints.
Willingham's physical stature did not demand respect, but he did.
I was at the midget football game, and there's this little football player just running all over the field and nobody can catch him and nobody can tackle him. And I'm asking, who is this person that nobody can catch? And they said, that's Tyrone Willingham.
I would see him often late at night shooting basketball with, while he was in junior high, one of the stars of the high school team who was 6'3". And Tyrone's about 5'7", 5'8". And they would be playing one-on-one.
He felt like he may not win, but he'll make the winner break the record.
He was an all-conference performer in basketball, football, and baseball. He could throw the ball 75, 80 yards.
I was not obviously the biggest man, nor am I the biggest man today, but I was told that if you shoot for the moon and you miss and you land on the roof, you're still up.
True to that dictum, Willingham wrote 100 letters to Division I-A schools requesting an opportunity to become part of their program. Two colleges responded, Toledo and Michigan State.
He used to always tell me, I don't want my mother and my father having to pay for my education anymore. He said, I want to earn a scholarship.
Ty came in a student, athlete, not on scholarship, to walk on. He, through his persistence, his diligence, hard work, became a football player, second year on scholarship.
When the guys would go out, Ty was the one that kept us in line. He was the one that would get us up in the morning after being at parties the night before. Sometimes we'd be in the bed asleep, and Ty would be down on the floor doing push-ups.
Playing football and baseball at Michigan State, Willingham was awarded the Big Ten Conference Medal of Honor for athletic and academic excellence. After graduating in 1977, he set his sights on a single prize.
Shaver doesn't shave close, everybody hurts. Norelco's unique triple head technology gives you the world's closest rotary shave. So when you want to get close, reach for a Norelco.
As you gather around the table this Thanksgiving,
smell of my pit.
Give a thought to those less fortunate. The Cheap Seats Thanksgiving Day Marathon.
Always funny.
A new look at the old game. Beginning 7 a.m. Eastern on ESPN Classic.
Comedy gold.
And every life of fame, success, and drive hides a story of humility, demons, and pain. To really know the hero, you've got to reveal the human. The award-winning Sports Century, 8 p.m. weeknights, only on ESPN Classic.
Home.
home is where the hoop is with the ESPN Full Court College Basketball Pay-Per-View Package. Catch up to 30 games a week all season long for only $99 or two payments of $49.50. To order, go to directtv.com, call 1-800-GET-SPORTS, or tune to channel 215 to order with your remote.
DirecTV HD. Leading the HD revolution with the launches of NBC HD and Bravo HD. Order now and get 6 months free. DirecTV HD. This is the picture.
Now on pay-per-view, some girls are nice.
Regina seems sweet.
Some girls are naughty, and some are downright mean.
You like Aaron Samuels? I could talk to him for you if you want.
Mean Girls, rated PG-13. Order it now on pay-per-view.
After bouncing around the country for 18 years as an assistant, the last six under Dennis Green, first at Stanford, and later with the Minnesota Vikings, Willingham finally was given his first head coaching job when he returned to Stanford for the 1995 season.
There are two people that made the decision for Tyron Willingham. One is Ted Leland, the other is Condoleezza Rice.
She had said publicly that she wanted the athletic director to look at minority candidates. And everybody knew what that meant. It meant hire a minority candidate.
Glenn Dickey was just wrong, and I can remember calling him and saying that he didn't write that a certain coach was hired at another university because he was blonde. So why would he say that Tyron Willingham was hired because he was black?
When we first hired Tyron to replace Bill Walsh, and here you go from a Hall of Famer, an icon, to someone that nobody knows, and all I said was, spend 5 minutes with this guy and then tell me we made a mistake, and not one person ever did that.
He just oozed himself into the situation. He did not make any dramatic, giant steps. He just kind of emerged as the football coach at Stanford.
Tyron was a great NFL coach, but his heart was in college football.
Our strength is that we play as one, one mind, one body.
He always had this little thing to show how disciplined he was. Like, we always go out to the swimming pools, and he'll dive in the water, and then the other players will get in with him and then try to see who can hold their breath the longest. And, of course, he always stayed on the longest.
He is probably in as good a condition or better condition than probably most of the players.
So often in training camp, he'd be rollerblading over to the training table. How many Division I, major Division I head college coaches would be rollerblading across the campus?
A man's life's really regimented. Like, I remember him telling me he eats a bowl of oatmeal every morning. And so I start waking up eating oatmeal every morning.
The kids will make fun of him at times and say there's Tyron time and there's real time. On an itinerary, it's nothing for him to put on there 9:32 a.m. Not 9:30, not 9:35, but 9:32 a.m. That's just Tyron. He is to the minute.
He's obsessed with the weather. He has a Palm Pilot constantly checking the weather because he feels like every morsel of information will help him be more prepared and help the team be more prepared.
He would always tell us in practice, there should never be a day when you should be tired. You should always have energy. You should always want to go out and live.
Tyron likes to be the official for the two-minute drill. One of our quicker, faster wide receivers had caught a pass and broke loose and was running down the sidelines. And right behind him, running just as fast as he was Coach Willingham. And we couldn't really decide whether that meant we were in trouble at wide receiver or that we were in good shape with our head coach.
He doesn't have to come and yell at you. He just gives you a little look from across the field, and that lets you know that you made a mistake and that you need to correct that as soon as possible.
If I get in trouble at school, I didn't worry about my parents. I was worried about if Coach Williams was going to find out.
I would see him over there on the sideline, you know, watching him very low key on the sideline. And yet that Stanford team was sky high. They were after us and they would beat us.
Despite three losing seasons, Willingham took Stanford to the Pac-10 title and its first Rose Bowl in 28 years. In 2001, he ended his career in Palo Alto as only